What's this thing you got against Sufi?
They're complacent.
You were just attacking Chopping Pots and the sort of bands that are on there. What, do you think they're relevant to the kids 16, 17?
Of course they're not. Relevant to their mums and dads, but that's about all.
What about bands like Rod Stewart?
What about him?
Mums and dads, yeah.
He's all round, isn't he? All round entertainment.
He's an old f***.
Rod Stewart gets up there and starts, like, going on with his string orchestra, you know what I mean? It's not what you feel like. So you've got to have some music what you feel like. Otherwise you go balmy, don't you?
I think their attitudes really stink. Now, anyway, it's just like... There just has to be new groups, and then that's what you got.
The Sex Pistols say they hate hippies, everything they stand for, and the hippies are what went wrong with music. What do you think about that?
Yeah, right.
I think that's where the complexities came in, you know? When people thought, oh, we better buy a Moog synthesizer, or we'll get caught out, you know? Like,
if
maybe...
If there's any around, they should, like, you know, jump into action immediately. Because, you know... I suppose it ain't their fault. They've had too much dope.
Yeah. Lying on the floor and looking at the ceiling.
But it's another generation to you.
Yeah, one that went wrong.
Groups like the Sex Pistols and politics and were inspired to self-expression.
I felt so energised and so excited at the time that I wanted to do something myself. And the thing that I really wanted to do was write. I never wanted to be in a rock group. That was never a particularly viable option. And the only other thing to do at the time was to write, and also I was interested in graphics and visuals. So I was working at the time, and in my lunch hours and any time I could sneak away, I stuck together what was then called a fanzine, either on the bog at work or on a pub or somewhere, and Xeroxed it at work, and eventually got it printed and produced that at the end of November 1976.
Punk wasn't just a new brand of music, it seemed to offer revolution in every aspect of life.
It was, if you like, an explosion of the new. I mean, it happens in all sorts of ways at various different times. This society, particularly at the moment, is all about, you have a great pressure of weight at the establishment and institutions keeping forces that act for change down, because we are living in a time of extreme change, very rapid change, and that change isn't allowed to express itself. And it was rather like a dam bursting, that enough water had built up over the last 10 years, and then suddenly the dam burst. And of course, when a dam bursts, you get a lot of power in a very short space, in a very concentrated space.
Queen got to number two in Jubilee Week, and the Sex Pistols were internationally infamous. On a holiday in the sun, I wanna go to the New Bell Sun. But within a year, the Pistols would split up, and with them many people's hopes that punk would change things permanently.
And of course, it never really happened. And that was the same in a different way with the Sex Pistols, because I remember Jamie Reed telling me that they all thought that they would just be the start. And what in fact happened is they were the only punk group, and most of the other ones that came out afterwards were, if not pathetic, then sort of fatally flawed. I mean, The Clash, after being initially wonderful, turned into a bunch of social workers, very successful, very honourable social workers, but social workers nonetheless. And the Damned and all the others were just sort of hyped up entertainment, really. No, I mean, I'm not putting them down for that, but it meant that the original thing was diluted. And that sort of very pure expression of energy got diluted.
Politics and punk, I didn't really take it seriously then. I also think that many of the kids, quite frankly, they weren't taking it seriously. You had obviously many aware kids, and I mean politically aware, not sort of aware generally, who obviously thought it was serious and they were going to change the world. But all you do is shift it from one side to the other. And I think for a while they did actually shift it maybe slightly to the left.
Susie and the Banshees are one of the few punk groups not to give up or change their attack. This year, Susie got her own record label. An early Sex Pistols fan, her first appearance on stage was in 1976 at the first punk festival.
Tried to get a band together?
Yeah, I did the 100 Club, the punk festival. Susie and the Banshees.
What did you sing?
The Lord's Prayer via Twist and Shout, Knocking on Heaven's Door, and a bit of Deutschland, Deutschland, Uber Alle.
And what went down the verse?
All of it. It got boring in some parts, but it picked up.
Are you a singer?
Yeah.
Had you sung before?
Not on stage, no.
Did you think that was important?
No.
And who was backing you up?
Sid Vicious on drums, Steve Spunker on bass, Marco on guitar, and me just doing the vocals.
7 years later, in the Candlelock shop run by a friend Morticia, I tried my hand at interviewing Susie and Steve.
The only rubbish that there is to get sucked into business and into thinking about shifting units and all that kind of business talk, which unfortunately a lot of people that are making music are thinking more about business than making music.
Yeah. Or you simply have to tailor your business to fit your music rather than tailor your music to fit an industry that thinks it knows better, because it doesn't, because it's full of idiots.
Susie thinks the revolution failed because of media resistance.
Well, it's down to there's too much power in the wrong places. It's closed up so much within TV and radio. I mean peak radio and TV, you know, then shove things on late at night, you know, because no one's awake to watch it or something, or they're preaching to the converted anyway.
Yeah.
But there's just too much power with those kind of people.
Yeah, and they decide what's... I hope to God you're not a zombie.